Yes, good morning, Uganda. Good morning, people. You're welcome to a lovely show where we are going to be examining Uganda's excitement at the news that we can see the end of AIDS in our lifetime, specifically in 2030. Yesterday was World AIDS Day, a day we commemorate, we remember the people who have we have lost, the people who have fought so hard for HIV and AIDS, and we re-examine our efforts and see whether we are on course. And yesterday, government told us that Uganda is on good course, that we are going to be able to see the end of AIDS by 2030. So, as responsible people, we gathered here to analyze, to see whether it is a hopeful statement or a realistic statement. And in the studio here, I have gurus that have been in the fight for HIV in this country for a long time. And outside, we have three other people linked by Zoom who we are going to be discussing whether Uganda is actually able to see the end of AIDS. And the end of AIDS is described as a time when we may have HIV, even infecting people, but nobody will be progressing to the disease stage or even dying from AIDS-related sicknesses. So that will be good news, but is it right to hope? So in the studio, I have three people who I will ask to introduce themselves. So that before we continue, but I can just say that on my left is Asia Russell. Asia, you're welcome.
Thank you, Harry.
Next is Dr. Stephen Watiti. Doctor, you're welcome.
Thank you. Nice being here.
And we also have Sylvia Nakasi. Sylvia, you're welcome.
Thank you.
So, Asia, you could introduce yourself and how you are linked to HIV, and then we continue like that.
My name is Asia Russell. I'm the executive director of HealthGap, and HealthGap is a global AIDS treatment access organization. We work side by side with people living with HIV and communities most at risk of HIV infection here in Uganda and in six other countries in East and Southern Africa. And we challenge the US government to do what's necessary in order to defeat HIV. And for HealthGap, we've been in this journey for 20 years, and today marks 40 years, approximately, of the AIDS pandemic. So it's a pleasure to be with you
brilliant,
in the studio today
brilliant.
To talk about it.
That is good. And Asia is so knowledgeable about the going-ons, either here in the country, in the rest of Africa, and above all among our funders, the development partners. Mm-hmm. We are so honored to have you, Asia. The next is a well-known columnist, Stephen in the New Vision, member, our member also. So, Dr. Stephen.
Yes, good morning, Hilary, and good morning, all colleagues. My name is Stephen, Dr. Stephen Watiti. I am one of the over 1.4 million Ugandans living with HIV and living openly with it. I've lived with HIV for over 30 years and I'm aging gracefully with it. So I'm glad to be here to be able to share a few insights. I'm also a clinician. I've been working in the HIV world for over 15 years. I've been working as a doctor for close to 35 years. So I'm a senior citizen.
You're welcome, Dr. Watiti. Dr. Watiti also produced a book. He's a publisher. And we are honored. He's our columnist. Every Monday you read his advice. Doctor, we are so honored to be here. This is a team that will analyze it properly. Thirdly, we have Sylvia. Sylvia, you're welcome.
Thank you. My name is Sylvia Nakasi Butiga. And I'm the executive director at Uganda Network of AIDS Service Organizations, UNASO. We exist to coordinate, to represent civil society organizations at different national and regional policy forums. and we are there to work closely with civil society. We bring them together, we advocate, and we document issues that affect people living with HIV, the HIV response, and we communicate. And we are not service, we don't do service delivery per se, but we coordinate organizations that work on HIV and AIDS.
Very good. Now you see Sylvia is the giraffe in the NGO world. and in HIV fight, we have doctors, we have people living with HIV, we have advocates, activists, we have NGOs, we have government. So here we are very well represented. Out there we have Dr. Flavia Matovu Chiwewa. She is a researcher at Muju, Makerere University, and John Hopkins University Research Collaboration. So, Dr. Flavia, if you are listening, please say a word. Okay. As Dr. Flavia comes in, we shall break and allow her to speak. Outside, we also have Dr. Joshua Musinguzi, the person in charge of HIV programs at the Ministry of Health. So Musinguzi will be representing government in this. And Dr. Musinguzi, when you're able to speak, we'll also welcome you. We also have Esther Nakazi. She will represent journalists. She has been a health, a science and technology journalist for a long time. She's a media activist in HIV. And she's the president of HEJUN, which is Health Journalists of Uganda Association. She is responsible. She has trained so many journalists on HIV. So these are people who know what is taking place behind the scenes. And these are people who know that maybe it is true. Maybe there are impediments. Maybe if we don't do ABCD, we may not see the end of AIDS. So we are here up to noon, and in order not to waste time, as we wait for the people offshore to log on, I will ask us to start right away. Now, we'll start like this. I have explained that ending AIDS doesn't mean eradicating HIV. It means that we stop people from dying of AIDS acquired immune deficiency syndrome. That means people may have HIV but live with it up to their full lifespan. And that means the end of the struggle, a long struggle from a long time of when HIV was a killer to when it is impotent. So the government has assured us that from their projections, by 2030, that is 10 years from now, we shall not have AIDS killing anybody. And I will like to start with Dr. Watiti. That is certainly good news. Do you believe it?
Well, I am an optimist. I think positive should be my middle name, Stephen Positive Watiti. Given the way we are doing things now, we may not necessarily get that. But having a vision is good, and realizing now, because from the figures which were given now, that there are 21,000 deaths annually. That translates to about 57 people dying daily. And that translates to about 2 people dying. So by the end of this talk show, some 4 people have died of AIDS. Now, what kills them? We know that. Are we doing what is supposed to do? For example, when we started the test and treat, which was very good news, which all of us thought, wow, then we're going to get it. The problem is that there are some people who are started on treatment when they don't know their CD4 count. CD4 count is what measures how badly damaged your immune system is, and therefore how prone you, how much prone you are to serious opportunistic infections. And by this, I mean the big killers like TB, meningitis, and other brain infections like toxoplasmosis. All these happen, especially when you have a CD4 below 200. So now, many people don't know their CD4 count. If you go to any health center in Uganda where they test for HIV and ask, now you have tested 5 people, how many of these have you tested for CD4? You may not find that. Many times they do, but many times they are not doing it. The second thing that we have, which we saw during especially the COVID-19 lockdown, is that many people don't have comprehensive knowledge of the ARVs. For example, people just describe their medicine by color, by shape, or the color of the bottles. So many of them, when they walked, because we're locked, I get my ARVs from Mild Mayon Entebbe Road. My mother is in Bali, so I'm locked there. I go to a nearby health center, Busan Health Center 3, and ask for ARVs. But they say, "What are you on?" I said, "The white one." Because I didn't carry the bottle, because I don't want my mother to know that I'm on ARVs. So I just picked a few, which I tell her these are my vitamins, but they are finished. So that's the problem. So one, the two things which I want to stress is lack of what I would call, or what could they call, point of care CD4 count. That wherever you test for HIV, they should also use the same blood almost, test for CD4. Mm-hmm. So they say, "We're giving you ARVs, but look, we need to look more because your CD4 is quite low." So that is one of the issues. The other thing is that we are going to, you walk here because you are not so sick, but we're putting on ARVs, but you must follow them with good adherence. "But I'm not sick, I don't feel sick, I'm okay." Say, "Yeah, but your CD4 is 200 or 100, therefore you're very at high risk." So that's what makes me fear, but I hope we can put it right. If we can invest in treatment literacy, if we can invest in this point of care technologies where we can do CD4 count, and then even be able to stringently screen all people for TB, because TB is the biggest killer. It kills about 35% of the people who die of HIV-related, AIDS-related causes. So those are my fears. Having said that, I'm hoping that we can put our act together. Invest in treatment literacy, massive, not only people living with HIV, but even the community. That's what I think.
I think that's brilliant, because you talked of laboratories and equipment, the need for labs, so that puts it in the hands of government. Yes. So if we have the labs for screening CD4, for screening TB.
Yes.
If we can also have that treatment literacy to help in adherence.
Mm-hmm.
So that puts it both in the hands of government and also in the hands of the individuals.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, so Asia, to you next. Also in the context of what Dr. Watiti has talked about, the technology, boils down also to funds availability. So from your standpoint, are you hopeful that this will be available and we are going to see an end of AIDS within 10 years?
The issue is that Uganda definitely can see an end of AIDS in our lifetimes, but it will not without the kind of critical course correction that Dr. Watiti has described, and that involve a few other key interventions. In fact, much of the science that shows we can defeat HIV actually came from Ugandan researchers and Ugandan experts and Ugandan communities. Uganda, in the scientific and research communities, has been a trailblazer. The issue is the science stops too often at the clinic door. So people suffering and dying unnecessarily must wait years until they get the best TB treatments, the best triple combination therapy, timely access to screening and diagnostics, and more. So I want to talk about three areas where, unfortunately, this course correction is urgently needed by all partners, whether that's government of Uganda, PEPFAR, the US government, other bilaterals, and communities. And that's around funding, around strategies, laws, and policies that include human rights of those communities that are most at risk, of gaps, deadly gaps, in access to treatment and prevention. And that's around these kinds of comprehensive, innovative approaches that Dr. Waititi was describing. If you look at the data, yes, Uganda's coverage of HIV treatment has surged. And that's been because over the last 5 years, people with HIV and their comrades detected a slowdown in treatment scale-up and they fought for test and treat. They actually went out and detected stockouts in facilities, and they shined lights on that gap in service delivery. And as a result, government changed the policy and test and treat became a reality. Now coverage has increased. So almost 1.4, 1.5 million people are living with HIV in Uganda. About 1.2 are on treatment. So that's an important marker of coverage. But the problem, the Achilles heel in the program, is quality. It's retention in care, which cannot be an afterthought. And how do we know that this is true? Because of all those 1.4, 1.5 million people with HIV, about 60% do not have what's called suppressed viral load. The science is amazing. It shows that if you are suppressed on treatment, you cannot transmit HIV to anyone else. That's why you can live a long, healthy life.
And you don't die of AIDS.
Exactly. And HIV stops. Treatment is liberating because it saves lives. It's a human right. In addition, it prevents onward transmission. So it's a two-in-one. But Uganda's data show that 62% of people living with HIV overall don't have suppressed viral load. And that's actually much worse for some subpopulations, adolescents, children, and adult men. So men aged 20 to 49 have very low rates of suppressed viral load. That's hugely concerning because we know this is the population that's less likely to come in and get services that they have a right to. Also, we know they're sexually active. That means a new round of transmission every single day. Right? So that's 1,000 new infections every week that can all be prevented with access to science. But those men are not coming into care, and it means something is wrong with the strategy, the funding, and the laws and policies, because those people are falling through the gaps.
Correct, yeah.
One other key point to make, there are these vulnerable populations I've mentioned, kids, including HIV-exposed newborns, adolescents, girls and young women who experience such catastrophically high rates of gender-based violence, of avoidable pregnancy, and stigma and discrimination. Also, key populations are hugely important. So these are criminalized populations, sex workers, men who have sex with men, transgender people, people who inject drugs. We know HIV infection is higher among those populations because of stigma and discrimination. And the Ministry of Health has acknowledged this. The Uganda AIDS Commission has acknowledged that they must be reached with human rights supporting interventions. And we know they're not right now. Why? Because of onward transmission that's continuing to take place. Because we know people are dying alone and excluded because of stigma and discrimination. Mm-hmm. The good news is all of these issues can be addressed. The tools are there. Ugandans help discover these tools. Mm-hmm. The bad news is the strategy of partners and of government right now does not fully invest and prioritize these life-saving investments. So that has to change if this pipe dream is going to become a reality.
Mm. Brilliant. I'm impressed by the analysis. The good thing is that it is possible. We have all the tools and the implementers are there, the science is there. Before I go to Esther, I wanted to ask you something. You talked of 60% viral suppression failing, but yesterday government was saying that we have achieved 90% viral suppression of the people who are on ARVs.
So the confusion there is a global target that Uganda has committed to, which is called the 90-90-90 target. Everyone has committed to realizing this global goal of defeating HIV, not just Uganda, by 2030. And that 90% that was mentioned by government is about that target. So in brief, what it means is there are these 1.5 million people, men, women, children, living with HIV, about 1.2 know their status, and about that same amount, according to the data, are on treatment.
Yeah.
And of those people, there is overall a number that are virologically suppressed. But that leaves aside those 200,000, 300,000 people who are not yet on treatment. And it leaves aside, we must take into account those people that are more likely to have unsuppressed viral load. It's not everybody. In fact, viral load suppression is much more common among adult women who are delivering that success above and beyond that average that I mentioned. Mm-hmm. So we need to applaud HIV positive women for blazing a trail in terms of the success of the country's program. And I mentioned it's adult men, adolescents of all genders, and young children who have drastically unsuppressed viral load.
And they stigmatize the population.
Absolutely, and they go hand in hand. Mm. So we see, they're telling us something. Are we listening? Mm. Why is it that adult men have drastically unsuppressed viral loads? They're suffering, they're getting TB, they're dying, they don't have to. They're also inadvertently transmitting HIV.
Yeah, and I think that's what he's saying, that we know there are many people who are not suppressed, because it leads to what I would call a high community viral load.
Yeah.
The high community viral load is the one which is translating into new infections. Mm. And we have said that there are about 1,000, over 1,000 new infections weekly. Now that's hard.
That's
so we are, it's like a revolving door. Mm. People are getting in, out, but more are getting in.
Yes.
So we cannot overcome it that way.
Oh.
Yeah, so we must stop the door, we must turn off the tap, and then tackle those who are inside. We are inside.
Mm.
Yeah. But the other thing is that the weakness with the 90-90-90 is that it assumes it's all about the virus. There are people, for example, who are of my age, older people, who have different problems. Like, for example, than the communicable disease. Because as you grow older, the chances of developing high blood pressure, the chance of developing
diabetes, cancer.
The chance of even getting depressed. Mm. You have issues. And when you are depressed, you're not going to swallow ARVs.
Sure.
When you don't have, so you're going to end up in the other group. And I'm not surprised that men are not doing very well. Mm. Because men are the ones who are bearing the brunt of this. You know, like for example, now we're having this economic depression because of COVID. Mm. Men are bearing the brunt of it. School fees, food, and so on and so forth. And mental health is a big, big problem. So we need, I have argued in another forum that we need a fourth 90, which measures the quality of life of people living with HIV.
Ah, yeah. That's good. And HIV fight has been both, it's primary care, the everybody, people, government, partners, and groups, and NGOs also. So, Nakasi, this is where I would love to bring you in. You coordinate NGOs which help force do activism in the HIV fight. And from that vantage point, and from what has been discussed already, okay, what is your view, first of all, about the ability of Uganda to see the end of AIDS by 2030.
Thank you, Hillary. Like my colleagues have shared, we are hopeful that we can get there. However, if we don't change business as usual, we are likely not to get there. There are things that impact access to treatment, issues to do with adherence to treatment. And we all know that adherence to treatment is affected by so many things. One of them is stigma and discrimination. You find that low investment or less focus on addressing stigma and discrimination in our communities will impact greatly. Because even when I'm tested HIV positive, for example, you've told me all the benefits of being on treatment, but I'm not given the necessary support to adhere to my treatment. I will not adhere. And in the process, I'll get resistance, but I'll continue to spread the virus. Having 1,000 people getting infected weekly is unacceptable. And I think however much we put people on treatment, if we don't give them quality treatment, we don't follow to ensure that they're on treatment, they have the necessary support, you find that, like doctors said, we open the door, but then the door is revolving. So however much you're putting so many on treatment, so many are getting infected in the process. But we also find that we have HIV prevention options that work. We have the condoms, we have voluntary medical circumcision, we have new tools that have proven to work, like PrEP. But how accessible are they to the community? Do people know the information about these tools? However much I want to prevent myself from HIV, where do I get the condom in my community? Unless I go to a health facility. So unless I'm sick, I won't go to this corner or to this dispenser in the health facility to pick the condom. But then at times even you get there and the condoms are not there. So I don't have 1,000 shillings, I don't have 2,000 shillings in my pocket to go to the shop. But even when I go to the shop, I'm scared of asking for a condom during the day, because the teller will wonder, at this time of the day, you're going to have sex? You know, we have stigma attached to condoms that probably they are used by sex workers. So there's that stigma. The knowledge in our community about the HIV prevention options is still limited. So if we enhance that, probably we'll try to reduce on the new infections, but also enhance our information on mitigating and getting to the 2030. But also when you look at investment in HIV response, in 2014, a law was passed to have the AIDS Trust Fund. As we speak now, I think 6 years down the road, there's no AIDS Trust Fund. And you find that there's a limit to how much donors can give us. As we all know, the funding to HIV is dwindling. PEPFAR and Global Fund are one of the biggest funders of our HIV response. But you find that very little, I think 7% comes from government. So to what extent are we going to depend on these donors? And they have their focus as well. They will say, we are giving so much, but our main focus is on treatment, making sure more people get treatment. Many are retained on treatment. But you find interventions to do with community, interventions, support, adherence, less is going there. Or maybe what is going there is not adequate enough to sustain people on treatment. So if we have domestic financing, for example, the AIDS Trust Fund, probably that fund can address interventions that our donors are not probably putting money into. And yet these adherence support mechanisms are there to support and to enhance that whoever is put on treatment is sustained, and we make sure that they benefit from the advantages of being on treatment. But we also find there was a hope of rolling out the unique identifier. You find that if I'm shy from getting medication from my village, for example, during the COVID pandemic, you find that many people had run out of drugs, but they were scared of going to the nearest facility. Either because of the stigma attached in the community, they are scared to be identified as people living with HIV. But you find even when they go to their facility, they can't identify the drugs they've been on. So if we have a unique identifier, a system that can tell the health worker that Sylvia is on this medication, this is her other complications related to her medication or her HIV status, you find that you solve a lot of problems. So even when I'm shy to go to my facility, if I probably go to a facility far away from where I always get my drugs from, because of the unique identifier, the health worker will be able to give me adequate information, but also the medication that I need. Mm. So you find that we are helping each other, but also ensuring that people access the treatment that is required, but also adhere to the treatment. But with this, I don't know what, for lack of a better word, we are just trying things, but probably we need to...
Yeah, yes, Sampo, by the way, when you have problems, you go and register again. So, for example, Hillary, you go back to Ibanda, assuming that's where you come from.
Yes.
And you are stuck there. You try to go somewhere, they refuse. So you go and test somewhere. Of course, you find you positive. So you'll be a first person. They initiate you on treatment. This way in Kampala, where you are, you are lost to follow up. The they other day, they are reporting as a new patient. So that mix up. And sometimes that, so that brings problem. But we are not here to lament, really. We are here to see how we can improve, how to get to 2030 faster, even earlier, and smarter. You see? For example, here, it's the issue he has raised of the unique identifier. You cannot withdraw your money twice in anywhere. Go to an ATM here. If you go to Nakawa, it will tell you you have withdrawn the money.
Yes.
The same, because of the, that, and with computers everywhere, we can link this up. With connectivity, we can do this. We need to check this list. But this 1.6, really, the 1.6, so what it registered as Masaba here, and as Okewa, the other side, and as Mukasa, the other side.
And also as a death somewhere.
Yeah, some of them might have died. Yeah.
To follow up. But also, when you talk about this, I imagine we are also dealing with a lot of rural communities where we don't have facilities like power, like labs, like now that unique identifier will need the computer access to mainframe.
Instead of using names, you use it.
How possible is this going to be in a Uganda like, which is, we have a lot of people in rural areas, fewer in urban areas. It seems like the HIV will be successful in urbanized communities only with access to.
I think these are not really, we're not looking for computer, I mean rocket things. Things where you can put a finger, you know, this is something, for example, the Electoral Commission, when it works, you are supposed to put your finger, it's identified that this is where Nomugisha. Even if you use another name, but this is the finger, because there is only one person with that finger.
Yes, yes.
Now that is more easier, that's what we are saying, working smarter. And I think there is enough money to invest in that one.
And I think it's absolutely true that that kind of technology can reach everyone. But let's not ignore the elephant in the room. It's quality. We just did rounds of community-led monitoring, which networks of people with HIV were at the forefront of. So that means going out into rural communities, into urban settings, everywhere in the country to actually talk to service users and say, what is your experience with getting care from these very well-funded implementing partners of PEPFAR or from a health center for? How did they treat you? How did the midwife treat you? Did someone visit you when you were lost to follow-up? To get at the truth versus the numbers. And what we found was astonishing. In rural communities, we found, particularly during COVID, we found people who were completely abandoned. They made their way to facilities and they were told that there were stockouts, that they couldn't get their HIV-exposed infants tested for HIV and get those test results in a timely fashion. So when you go to rural communities, the issue is quality and that diligence by big US NGOs, frankly, to actually invest in community-led support, to pay people with HIV to get on a bicycle, a living wage, not a pittance, a living wage, to go out into communities and with respect and discretion say, Hillary, what's happening? Can you come back in with me? Because I'm very worried about your health. That's not what's happening. We see gumboots here, a bicycle there, a little sprinkling of airtime, and then implementing partners expect that people with HIV will magically be able to find incredibly sick, in some cases, people catastrophically ill with TB. We saw an 11-year-old with HIV and drug-resistant TB, a girl who got turned away from a facility because she had transferred on her own because she was so desperately ill. Her caregiver had brought her in, and that facility was so upset to see her because she was not one of their patients. She was told to walk away and come back with a paper transfer. It's 2020. That is unacceptable, but that's happening every day. So yes, let's get the unique identifiers. Let's demand once and for all that these quality issues by donor partners in particular are really addressed. with money, with policies and strategies that put communities at the center and that pay them a living wage, that cut through the laws and the stigma and the discrimination, why are there still shortages of condoms in Uganda? Condom use and access to condoms has gone down in the country, not up. Why are PrEP targets so low when the data on PrEP came from Uganda? Only 37,000 people have access to PrEP right now. And the data came from years and years and years ago. It should be a national program with treatment literacy and prevention literacy going hand in hand, but that's not where we are. So that's the kind of gap that we need to fill, and that's the energy that we need to invest in if we're to achieve that 2030 goal. It's achievable.
I think what you're saying is important. We also have some of these, by the way, they're promises, they're policies. We are very good at policies, but when you look at the budget, because every policy to be put in practice must have a budget line.
Yes, yes, a budget.
So when you check the budget, where is the money going to come? Then there's no money. Mm-hmm. For example, there are people called linkage facilitators in this country. These are supposed to be HIV positive people who go out there and look for people and supposed to bring them. And there are some of the IP implementing partners use them. But you see, if you go out there to test with a kid, maybe to test, and you don't find a positive person, that day you will not be facilitated. Yeah. I hope this has stopped, but there was a time, and I'm the chairman of National Forum for Living with HIV Networks in Uganda. Some people have told me that, look, doctor, in Soroti, in some places in the East, if I go out and I don't come back with a person who is positive, I'm not going to get facilitation. So sometimes the Ugandan thing in them say, look, Hillary or Steven, I know you are positive. Please, let me test you, and you have a positive result so that I get this money.
Some money. Yeah. Yes.
So you are testing me, I know I'm positive, so you go with a positive result. But really, that's not good. Why are people being forced to do this?
Like, but now it also boils down to resources, to staff. We're about to go for a break, but I can see brilliant suggestions, but then they boil down to staff, like availability of staff. We have few people in the health sector, and some are running away because of remuneration, because of the risk, because of the stress of lack of.
Therefore, we are saying it's like I'm going to drive to Jinja, and I'm reaching Mavira, and the thing is showing red. There's no way I'm going to reach Jinja.
Yes.
I should have budgeted. I should have known.
Put enough fuel.
Yeah. You cannot say I'm going to Jinja and then you reach Mavira and the gauge is red and then you say I'm going to Jinja by midday. You can't. So 2030, it can be red on paper unless we address the issues. For example, people have laid off counselors. If you go to a typical health center, there is no such a thing as a counselor.
And then there is also testing and counseling.
Yes, there are supposed to be pre-testing, counseling. There is supposed to be adherence counseling. We have to budget for this. Even the peer counselors, peer counselor, I mean people living with HIV, they must be trained. At least give them some basic training. Some of them just use their own experience, which is good, but look, you must be able to be empowered and then remunerated. Mm. Using because they know how much sugar costs in the community. Why are you making me work and you know I cannot even buy half a cloof of sugar for my family? Mm-hmm. Or for sure.
I think Dr. Msimkhe has to talk about this, but before he comes in, do you know that this money is there and it's not being used properly, or it is lack of funds?
I think the issue, so there are two issues. One is making sure that donors walk the talk around communities. And that means setting aside sufficient budgets so that instead of counselors being told that they must, find people with HIV and bring them in order to get paid for the day, they get a living wage, which is what, in fact, government policy around CHOOS support as well. So that will not break the bank of the PEPFAR investment in the country. The issue is holding implementing partners accountable to putting those resources there instead of big administrative budgets. Does that make sense? So that means saying people with HIV are the priority. Let's pay community health workers, train them, supervise them, give them the tools that they need, and that's what will bring up quality. Anything else is a pipe dream. So that's one aspect. The other aspect is, in fact, indigenous investment, which Sylvia has mentioned so eloquently. So we've seen the overall budget of the country expand, but that's been primarily in a few areas. Security, defense, infrastructure, not in health.
It has been shrinking for health, the percentage, yeah.
Not in health. So, and the particular way people feel that pinch is in health workforce. There's been some improvement, which is important, but particularly with health workers threatening to strike because of COVID, with people running from the job because PPE is not sufficient. COVID shows us the strain that affects not just folks with COVID, but people who are pregnant, people with HIV, tuberculosis. It exposes the weaknesses in the health system for everyone, those inequities. Mm-hmm. Those can be fixed, but you're absolutely right. It takes an expansion in national investment in those priority areas of the health system. Mm-hmm. Remuneration of staff, increased retention, equitable deployment of staff, so they're not all in the urban settings, but they're far flung.
Where the people are.
Exactly, where they're concentrated, where the inequities are, in the regions where inequities are, and that they're adequately supervised and held to account when they fail, so that the system delivers. That costs money. It will cost more than what the government invests right now, but it is possible. The resources can be found. They must be invested in people and in commodities and in communities.
Yeah, and the cost of not investing are the deaths.
Absolutely.
Because are we
not only the death but also reversal? The
reversal, yeah. So we must invest in this. So the issue is there money? Mm. It's not there, but it should be there. It should be there because we are looking at people. People are the biggest resource of the country. And good quality people, because they are the ones who are going to produce, they are the ones who are going to work. If they are sick or they are dying, then we are going to have difficulties even in our economy, because this is going to pull us down if we don't invest more in health.
But also, Sylvia, in the NGO world, because the NGOs are funded separately from government, do you, in UNASO, do you have a way you can redirect some NGOs to the vital necessary work that government is ignoring or failing to do? How much help are we getting from NGOs?
You find that, like I said initially, most of our HIV response is funded by PEPFAR and Global Fund. We've tried to emphasize the need for investment in community interventions, especially under Global Fund. Recently, we wrote a proposal for HIV, TB, and malaria. There was strong emphasis to ensure that we have community interventions funded in there. We've also done similar efforts, advocacy efforts under PEPFAR, and the trend is changing. But you find they need to strike a balance. We need to maintain the people on treatment, and that is through providing the commodities. But also you find these community interventions also to fund. But there's a limit to how much they can give us. They'll say, okay, I'm just giving an example. Out of 10, we need so much for commodities because maintaining 1.2 people on treatment is not cheap. So if we have to maintain that, we need to invest in a lot. And this is it's not a one-off because it's for life. So they need to invest more in treatment, but also you find the investment that comes to community is coming in, but we need to support that for us to have meaningful change that we want to see. Other than that, and that's where government, National AIDS Trust Fund and other channels or domestic financing, like the 0.1% of our MDAs, that is ministry and government departments, that's when they can come in to support that, because there's a limit to how much PEPFAR, Global Fund and other donors can put in. Find civil society are trying to enforce that, but you also find that donors also have their goals, they have their targets, they have their visions. So we need to work hand in hand, but also as government, as national national governments, we need to invest in that. We shouldn't really rely on our friends to do everything for us. We need to pull our socks up in terms of resources to ensure that we support, because these are our people. We are the Ugandans, we need to put in more.
Okay, Asia, you are an advocate, you are an activist. You know that donors are also stressed. There is a lot of work to do. So when we come back from break, we'll see how else do we call for more money investment into HIV. So listeners, we've been discussing the time we have, whether we achieve the end to AIDS by 2030. So after the break, we'll continue and bring in more discussants. So we'll come back after the break. Welcome back from the break. This is a panel of people who know what goes on behind the scenes in the HIV/AIDS management. We are discussing, in the light of World AIDS Day, we are discussing government excitement and therefore people's excitement that we are going to end AIDS within our generation, within our lifetime. Government promised us yesterday that by the year 2030, we shall see an end to AIDS. So that will mean we won't have people dying of AIDS. That means we'll have a lot of resources now to invest elsewhere. But what does it mean? It means that while HIV might be on, people will stop dying from HIV because they will be on life-saving treatment, ARVs, and these ARVs, when you adhere to them, you suppress your virus in the body, your infectiousness drops, all goes to zero. So, and then there are ARVs, there is PrEP. These are drugs you take when you are negative and exposed, such that you do not get positive. So if we continue doing this, according to government, by 10 years, will be home. And according to the ministry, Uganda is actually back to its level of being an icon. You know, when HIV started, we led the intervention, we were good, we were the best, then we were taken over as we slackened. Now, from a comparative analysis, in Kenya, they had also 21,000 AIDS-related deaths in 2018. We also had the same. They had 42,000 new infections in 2018. And they have 75% adults on ARVs. In Uganda, we have 85% adults on ARVs. Last year, we had 53,000 new infections. Tanzania has 75,000 people on ARVs. Last year they had 27,000 AIDS-related deaths and 77,000 new infections. It could also boil down to the total population, but the figures show that we were doing better, especially in terms of the promised commitment of the 90-90-90, but we will not go there. In the previous in the studio, I have Asia Russell, who ably explained what we need to do and what is dragging us down. We have Dr. Watiti, who also is actually at the front line. He disclosed his HIV status. He's both HIV positive and also active in people living with HIV and also in services, offering services. We have Esther Nakasi, who is working with UNASO, the NGO that links or NGOs which are active in HIV management. So that said, before in our discussion, before we went for break, we had identified several things. We said we need resources, we need money, we need to bring back health workers, we need to motivate them, even pay them. We need counseling services, both for testing and adherence. We said we need to bring, we need equipment of getting people to test both HIV, but also viral load and maybe CD4 count. We talked of the trust fund. Where did it go? I thought Joshua would explain to us, but we are still trying to get through to him. Maybe we shall also discuss where is this trust fund and what has happened, because we were about to get it. Now it again faded back. But the panelists think we are on course only if we do a few other things. So now my first question in this bit goes to Asia. These resources that we say we need, resources have been diverted to fight coronavirus. They are usually diverted. Now NCDs, non-communicable diseases, also have a very big advocacy for the same resources. We don't seem to increase donors at the same rate as our problems increase. So the donors seem to be the same, and then we fight for similar resources. So in the event that the government says there is no money, yes, we know this is needed, but there is no money. And that has been the song of government. If, like Dr. Musingu said, we don't have enough money, but in spite of that, we have achieved this. Even without that enough money, we can achieve 2010 end of AIDS. So what are we going to do if we don't have enough money? Can you tell me more about strategies possible for us to get more money into the HIV fight?
So I think there are three points. One is that finding and linking to treatment the remaining people is going to be more expensive than up to now. Why? Because these are people who experience discrimination, stigma, criminalization more acutely than populations that have been reached so far. They're also harder to reach adult men, who don't have health-seeking behaviors, who don't see themselves as needing to go to a clinic, who are scared and don't have any support from HIV-positive communities because they're removed from them. Criminalized populations like sex workers, who every time they go to seek services get harassed by police and get attacked or feel at risk of violence from their clients. That means we need not just creativity and innovation in reaching these people with the human rights driven approaches they require, but it also costs more money because it's not the same as women coming into antenatal care, which is a service that they're prioritizing because they're putting the health of their communities first. So that's one point. If we don't take this question of money seriously, we will not achieve these targets. I just want to emphasize that. Finding the last mile of people will be more expensive than up to now. So that means the stakes are high. We know globally there's more than a 30% funding gap between what is needed and what all parties have put on the table, whether that's poor countries, rich countries, patients themselves. In Uganda, there is a profound gap. The good news is we know the money can be found with political will. If government sees that investing in the health of people is as critical as investing in a road or in security or in police, we know that the money can be found because the budget's been growing. The population has been growing. What's not been growing is the political prioritization of the health sector. We also know donors can't be let off the hook. They also need to continue to invest and be accountable to the users of services, to communities themselves, for the priorities that they have, not the priorities that they dream up in an office in Washington, D.C. somewhere. Together, we can find these resources. Why I say that is because expansion has been able to happen year on year up to now. PEPFAR's budget won't grow forever, but it has been growing in Uganda. So we can continue to push. We must continue to push. Uganda increased its budget for antiretroviral treatments to 50 billion shillings in the last cycle of PEPFAR funding in the last budgetary cycle. So we know that these kinds of improvements are possible. They're not sufficient, and that's why we're here today. The AIDS Trust Fund was an innovation that actually people with HIV called for starting in the early 2000s. And year on year, it was avoided until finally in 2014. As Sylvia's mentioned, it was made into law in Uganda. The issue is it's not been operationalized. There's been a stalemate that's very concerning, because if from the year of passage into law, that tax had been collected up to now, 2020, we would actually be seeing hundreds of millions of US dollars accumulating and being able to be invested in these kinds of hard-hitting, life-saving, evidence-based services. We wouldn't see a condom gap because people would control those resources and say they must be invested in PrEP for adolescent girls and young women, PrEP for key populations, condoms for ensuring access to point-of-care CD4 and point-of-care early infant diagnosis wherever it's needed. But instead, those resources haven't been collected, so it's still a figment. We need to change that in 2021.
Oh, thank you. I've learned something that, you see, when you take people to care, the willing ones come first. So now those balance are more difficult. But now we have a bigger snag now in the country, is that the law criminalizes them. Like, of course, we cannot end HIV among people who have sex, men who have sex with men, because it's against the law. But they have services somehow, but they cannot come out openly. And in the event that we are not going to succeed to remove this law, maybe in the next 5-10 years. So, Dr. Watiti, how are we going to help? How are we going to manage, apart from money, to bring sex workers, drug users, MSM into care, into HIV care?
I think we will just have to accept and stop pushing our heads in the sand and assume this one is there. Because, for example, even the services, as you say, the services are there, then you put a, make, for example, the health workers are not sensitized. They make derogatory remarks about this when they come.
They even call others,
yeah,
come and see.
Come and see this one, is he a man? It's not good. It makes this poor. The brave ones may go there. There are a few who are activists who will go there, but those who are what? Who will keep quiet will say, well, we admire you, but I'm not going there. And these are people who are in our community. Some of them are MSM indeed, but they're also married and having sex with what?
With their wives.
With other wives and other people. And so this is the bottleneck. And like Asia has said, you know, when people are starting a marathon, I've been watching the Kampala Marathon, thousands start. But as they are finishing, you see the real marathoners. And they're also training, really pulling. And this is exactly what we must do. We must pull ourselves together. We must examine some of the things we have done, including the laws we have passed, even our attitudes. Can we afford to behave this way and hope to end HIV by 2030? This is just wishful thinking. It will remain on paper. People read about it, but then they will read, they will also see how we ended. So my view is the law, yes, but I think for me, the laws are there, but the way people behave. The way people behave. We've seen the law, and there are very good laws about rape in this country, good laws about speed limits, but you know how people behave when they are on the road. The way people behave is something to do with how we are shaped. We need to talk to ourselves. We need to examine that we want to bring this disease to an end. Away from even the sex workers and those ones, and the MSM who are, as they call key population, we have seen even within just dealing with the clear HIV, people fail to go there. Up to now, people, some of them say, no, I will not go to what? That health unit.
because of the way they are treated. So we need to do this. But having said that, I think with more investment, and by more investment, we are not saying they increase the money, because they have been increasing the money every year. We need to look at the percentage of the amount. And we had thought this would be worked on. Because you see, last year there was 90 billion, this year is 100 billion. But how many people are there? People have increased. Mm-hmm. Their needs are more. And as we have said, the looking for the last few is more difficult than these mm-hmm. others. Well, mm-hmm. you have to make a drama, come on for testing, and they come. Some of these you need to look for them more strenuously. And we need to more people be trained, people to be helped. So we are going to do it, but we are going to have to change the way we do things. We'll have to look at, examine some of the things which have worked and how do we improve them. But some of the things which have not worked so well, say, how do we remove this? Let's accept, for example, that the law is certainly something that disagrees us, but I don't think the law per se itself can. It is the way people behave. Most people, the way they treat. It's not because of the law, it's just because of the attitude.
Help me understand this. Almost 90% of HIV response is funded by the American people. So the government is putting, privately and what, then government is also putting a portion. If it is that small, how can government fail to? Because if you're saying 100, how much money does government put in? In terms
We don't have the statistics, but of course, government, the infrastructure is government. Mm. Most of the health workers is government. But when you see the money being spent on ARVs and other commodities, maybe up to 80%, but these statistics are with the ministry and
people.
We know that government has the capacity to be able to put money there. I think the issue has. My colleague has mentioned the issue of political will.
But even the capacity, I am doubting, because now we have a new challenge of coronavirus. Mm-hmm. We have other challenges like non-communicable diseases coming up. Mm-hmm. We have the whole.
That's why it is more important to focus on health than just focusing on a particular disease. Because people say, but
HIV is taking too much.
I think it's better to have HIV than to have diabetes. And it's a friend of mine who's going blind in Bukambu. Mm-hmm. Said, I wish I had HIV other than having diabetes. Because he can't afford to buy insulin.
And the issue ultimately is that it's the same community.
It's the same community, yes.
So,
that's why we need to advocate for improvement in health funding.
And the HIV response has really
And
shown
then, of course,
that.
Then we'll look at some of the other challenges, like the issue of corruption, the issue of food. These are small, fine-tuning, but we need to. But the corruption is worsened by the poor funding, because these people are not paid well and are not paid on time. So they somehow justify pinching something to take on and sell on the black market. Mm-hmm. Not saying it's right, but as they said, it happens.
There are causes, of course. Sylvia, in your NGO world, how far have you gone with lobbying, with advocating, with coaxing, forcing government to see these things?
There have been efforts, and I think we haven't been working alone. Civil society, we've worked closely with government counterparts, Uganda AIDS Commission, but also other civil society. We've engaged Parliament on the AIDS Trust Fund, and we managed to see the regulations be passed. However, there were issues that were raised on the floor of Parliament that the Ministry of Health had to address. So we are waiting the revisions to be shared on back to Parliament, and probably we'll see the way forward. But as you know, we are in this period of campaign, there's no probably that will come in the next parliament. And we are hopeful that probably this time round we'll have a positive move towards having the AIDS Trust Fund. But also you find that some of our policymakers or our key stakeholders in government, especially the Ministry of Finance, but other decision makers in some of our government offices don't appreciate why we need the AIDS Trust Fund. There's a view that the AIDS Trust Fund, the fund to fund HIV could be like any other fund. It could be a fund for cancer, fund for malaria, but you find that AIDS Trust Fund is different in a way that when someone starts treatment, it's for life. And sustaining this person for life, as we all know that we are living longer, but also if someone has been on treatment, they will stay longer, but this person needs treatment on a daily basis. So for how long will we depend on a donor to sustain that? The donors are also fatigued. So we need the domestic financing to come in to pull this on, because the resources will come, time will come when the resources are not enough for everyone. And given that more people are joining the queue, how will we sustain that with donor funding, with not enough domestic financing? So with the AIDS Trust Fund coming in, you find that it's unique in a way that will enhance the people who have started on treatment for longer, but also they will live longer. But also you find that there's need to integrate HIV management in other diseases. You find this same person, I have HIV, I have diabetes, I have cancer.
And
you know,
kidney.
I'm the same person. Mm. So if you tell me I can only give you HIV
medicine,
however, I don't have diabetes. So how can we have our health facilities integrate, do integration? For example, during COVID, you find that peers or people living with HIV will support their peers to take the medication to their facilities, to their homes during COVID time, the lockdown. But you find that you get to my home, you've come with my treatment for HIV, but you haven't brought diabetes. So if without integration, you don't know what other needs I have as a person. Yeah. But remember, I'm going to the same facility. But when I go to my clinic for HIV, I'll cross the compound and go for diabetes in the other corner, cross the compound, go for malaria in the other corner. So the integration is needed. When we integrate, probably we'll save resources, but also we'll enhance the quality of services for our people.
I think that's what I was saying, especially the importance of looking at a person in a holistic way. Other than compartmentalizing, saying this is the HIV watiti, this is the diabetes watiti. I mean, I'm the same person. Yeah. Now, when you get challenges like, and we won't have it getting worse. You see, as we go towards 2030 and so on, most of the people who are going to be living with HIV are going to be older, 50
okay,
years and above.
Doctor, let me cut you short. Let me cut you short, and we talk to Esther Nakazi. Esther Nakazi, you're welcome. Please, we'd like to know your views about ending AIDS by 2030. Esther Nakazi is a veteran journalist. We know you have the giraffe head. You are watching government. So tell us, Esther, what's your view? Okay, we are still failing to get the voice from Esther, but when it comes, we will put her back. I've got some few questions here. There is one still, I think, someone is saying, if we have our AIDS Trust Fund, it will not help because donors will know we have our money and they will also stop giving money. What do you think? Will it donors give us because we don't have? Now, when we have, they will say, ah, these people have, and they will take money elsewhere.
Well, it's coming anyway, because, you know, when we become a middle-income country, are we already or we are going to be soon? That means we don't qualify for some of the help that's given to poor countries. Because middle-income means you are now saying, like, I've been living with my father, but now I want to be independent. Mm-hmm. But you cannot go back and say, can I have salt? Can I have, where is breakfast? So it's a bit of that. But that aside, I think eventually it is the responsibility of the government to care for its people. Care for its people.
And I like Asia brings the human rights issue.
Yeah.
It's the rights of people to health.
Yes. Mm.
So there's an issue, which is government has an obligation to sufficiently fund the health sector, period, whether it's for HIV, diabetes, cancer, maternal health, sexual reproductive health and rights. That obligation is there. And at the same time, as civil society advocates, we have to make sure that donors don't say, oh, now that you're beginning to show a little leadership, see you later, mm-hmm. we're backing out. That's where accountability, monitoring, campaigning from civil society is so important, because health is political, ultimately. Mm-hmm. We know when people are better off, are more elite, it's easier for them to get health resources. It's people who suffer more who experience the barriers we're describing. That means we have to use our voices to fight for realization of those rights. So we'll make sure, doing our job, that donors don't step back abruptly as government steps forward and shows that leadership, so that we don't end up in this catch-22, in this double bind. Mm-hmm. We can prevent that with advocacy. Mm-hmm. But this core issue about sufficient funding is critical, and we've seen a lot of rhetoric around it, not just in Uganda, but in many countries, including my own country, by the way, about sufficient funding. Without the delivery of the models that have actually been proven to get people the medicine, the quality care, so that they can live long and healthy lives, whether it's with HIV or some other condition. You know, there was a landmark constitutional court judgment in Uganda that was just handed down in the middle of the COVID crisis around preventable deaths from childbirth.
Maternal health,
and
yes.
That is a health rights case. Dr. Steven, Sylvia, myself were together with CEHR, the Center for Health, Human Rights and Development, and many, a massive coalition of activists saying the judiciary must pronounce itself because government is violating the Constitution by not providing essential maternal health care services. We know more than 16 women die every single day in this country. That increased under lockdown. So we see if government's not stepping forward, these court cases, the prayers that were assented to by the judiciary were prayers to increase funding for the health sector. So that's a precedent that we all have to work to implement. It's historic, and it's a testament to the power of Ugandan advocacy that that judgment was handed down in favor of the most vulnerable and the most marginalized communities.
But it's also a dilemma. If you are a government and you have a small resource basket, you have health, you have education, you have security, you have infrastructure, you have all these, and you have to be equitable. Put money where you can get more money, and also put money where there are human rights. Would you starve education, for example, in order to fund health? Would you? So those are, I think.
I think that's quite. But of course, sick people cannot gain from education.
That's right.
And yesterday I was very excited when I saw the president opening a road, one of the best roads in the country, Bumbovi to Luahaha. It passes near my home. It's like people sit there and we are happy. But when people are sick or they have died, they can't use that road. So for us, And we will, and for me personally, I would just like Jesus said, of the 90, he had 100, this man had 100 sheep. Mm. He didn't count it, there were 99.
Yes.
Mm. There was one. So he left these ones and went and looked for the one. So we will keep pushing this, mm. using our last breath, that look, that last one must be helped.
Mm.
And that last one could be the marginalized person, the stigmatized person, but he's part of these people. They are Ugandans,
sure.
So they should be helped. So priorities, but I think we are suggesting that, okay, if we have especially percentages, they are easier to handle other than you just saying, I would prioritize and added there. But that's it. But what else has that to be? I think the important thing we are working on is that we are making it easier for government. We are part of government, of course, also we are. But we're making it easier for government by pointing out these things so that these things don't happen. Yesterday, yeah. I was very happy, by the way, to hear the minister roll out those statistics and the prime minister. And they were impressive. And that we are doing better, yes. And we are doing better than some countries. But you see, like I mentioned earlier, it is like looking at short people. Then say, okay, you are taller, we are now taller. But we don't have to be short. Comparing short people.
It's not what we are here for.
We must get to the bottom of this and make sure that people are helped. And especially the marginalized people.
Mm. Someone people here is saying that there is money.
Mm.
I think they want Sylvia to answer this, that there is money.
Mm.
The problem is that your NGO people are eating.
Mm.
Okay, corruption. It's about corruption. How can you rein in? Because this money is there. Everyone works in HIV. He's rich, he puts on weight, builds a nice house, then comes to complain that there's no money.
I think I will not agree with that statement that everyone who works in NGO is rich. Is true, corruption is there, and it's a hindrance to ensuring that we have quality services. So as NGOs, true, there's that vice, and it's across. Government, civil society, and this is advice that we need all to fight. Put our heads together and make sure that we stop it. But like I said, how can we ensure that this is stopped? There are efforts by civil society to enhance, empower communities to know their rights. You know, when you go to a community that is not knowledgeable of their rights, they can't even hold their leaders accountable. You find that those are in such communities, the people in power or the people who have resources tend to abuse those resources amidst these communities. But if we empower our communities to know their rights, we give them the necessary tools to hold their leaders accountable. We know what we expect from government. We know what was sent to our district, and we should monitor to ensure that this happens. So if the community is knowledgeable of what their rights are, they know what they're entitled to, they know what they expect from government or civil society, for example, they're able to say, look here, you promised to do A, B, C, D, but from the look of things, you've only done only A. What is happening with B? Or if you can't do A, B, C, please move away from our community. We've seen this happen in some districts, but also if communities are empowered, they can say, look here, that's unacceptable. If you can't do A, B, C, D, please walk away. So we need to enhance these efforts to empower our communities, to hold our leaders accountable. That's across government, but also civil society. Because I can't say we are 100% perfect as well. So we need to address the vice of corruption, because however much we bring in resources and it's leaked, then probably we are not attaining what we want to achieve.
I think it's true there are challenges, and I don't think the NGO world is immune from corruption. But I think the role that we play, especially the importance of demand creation, people accepting these deaths and this infection as if it is normal. No, we can normalize, say, no, this is normal.
We are even celebrating.
We are celebrating, yes. I don't like the idea of celebrating. Yeah. We should be mourning. We should be going to Kololo, all of us, mourning, and saying, look, we have lost this, but they shouldn't have died. Why did this people die? They died because we did not help reach them in time, or we did not reach them, but did not convince them to educate them on how to swallow this medicine well. We did not monitor them well. How can somebody on ARVs eventually develop cryptococcal meningitis and is now under our care?
Yep.
Why should a woman walk to hospital coming hoping to come back with a baby and then they bring back a dead body? This is not acceptable. In some places, the in charge of that place would resign. But of course, here we say God has called this person, and I don't think God is calling these people.
If they all resigned, we'd have no way.
Well, maybe then it would shape up. You see, most of the deaths related to AIDS are actually preventable.
Absolutely.
See? Even cancer, the deaths, if we diagnose it early, it would be preventable. You see, me myself, I'm a cancer survivor. But because it was picked early, I was treated and I'm now cancer free.
Congratulations.
So the issue is telling people that this is not right. And I think the civil society is good at this. We go to the people, tell them, no, somebody has died, but this could have been prevented. But this one, we can't stop this day, but can we stop the next one? Can we reduce? Because we have been talking about zero for a long time. When shall we have zero AIDS-related deaths? To celebrate that we're all, last time we were at 100 and now we're at 21, so we should celebrate. I think it's okay. We should say we are going the right direction.
No,
but let's hold on with the celebration until we can report that maybe some district, can you imagine maybe in one of the districts that there was no person who died in this year or no person who got TB? This is preventable.
Yeah. And someone wants clarification. Do we have to get 100% into ART in order to end AIDS?
So the issue there is, as we've been talking about, confronting unnecessary deaths to end AIDS. That's what's key. But what government has emphasized is that HIV treatment coverage is high. And that's something that's very important. But we're entering a very risky time when that figure will be celebrated instead of focusing on the indicators of quality, whether people are actually able to stay on treatment for life with the support that they need and the empowerment, the laws and policies that they require in order to live a life with dignity. And that's where we're not seeing the country on the right course, unfortunately. So for the coverage figure, as your viewer asked, we are almost there, and we see that's necessary but not sufficient. We have to reach everyone with treatment, but not just with the pills, with the information, with the empowerment, with the community health workers, with the diagnostic interventions, with the support for their other health needs. Then we'll get to defeating HIV. And prevention there, again, is critical for all sexually active people, for people at risk of infection. We see huge gaps in prevention in this country, and that is absolutely avoidable. You know, if Esther were able to connect with us, Nakazi, she would be talking about the innovations in prevention that happened in 2020, whether that's new data about cabotegravir, the twice-monthly injection for pre-exposure, prophylaxis, for which we got promising new evidence about its effectiveness in people at risk of sexual transmission of infection with HIV. The dapivirine ring, other innovation where, again, science is showing that getting closer to the prevention options that everybody at risk of HIV infection requires, the issue will be the gap between those important innovations and Ugandans being able to reach them. And this is where the resistance around rolling out effective, evidence-based sexual prevention in the country has really held incidence reduction back. That's why when we come back to this, 1,000 new infections every week, primarily among adolescent girls and young women, among key populations, among people who are also getting pregnant at a young age. Under lockdown, we saw violence, we saw teen pregnancies spike. These are also related to failures in HIV prevention that could be corrected if communities were listened to and if public health and human rights were put first, not this idea that, oh, if we just tell people to say no, it'll stop happening. When you act like that, deaths result unnecessary infections result in onward transmission, and that's why we're seeing this 1,000 new infections every single week and 700 deaths every single week, which are completely preventable.
Yeah.
Do you get an impression, because I'm getting it, that our successes are primarily because of the ART intervention and not elsewhere, because we seem not to be doing well elsewhere? Like, if we were doing well elsewhere in terms of reducing stigma, in terms of supportive care, in terms of all that, we would actually have ended AIDS by now.
Yeah, yeah, but of course, one can argue that even the ART success is because of reduction in that area.
Mm-hmm.
I think there is everything movement. But you see, statistics can be interesting when you throw 90%. We clap, of course, like everything. But when you go and check, for example, we are putting people massively on ARVs, which is good. But when you go to a particular, to go to health centers, you know, there's something that's called pharmacovigilance. Pharmacovigilance means that as you're on treatment, you are supposed to report any unwanted side effects.
Mm.
So you must know them. First of all, they should have told you what to look out for. But then if you go to these places and ask, where are the forms you have filled? The National Drug Authority gives these forms.
Mm.
You'll find they may not be there. That means they are not doing that work. That means there are people who are put on ARVs and nobody ever monitors or asks them any questions. Are you feeling this? Do you feel pain in your legs?
Yeah.
Do you sometimes have thirst? Are you putting on weight or losing? So these are supposed to what? All they are looking at is taking off blood. And if you have been swallowing your medicine well, the viral load would be suppressed. But nobody has asked the other questions. So these are the issues we are looking at. The quality of life of these people is as important as the people themselves saying they are alive, yes, but how well are they? How productive are they? Because when they see me, you see, some people think that by some of us talking openly that we are living a day, we have helped. But sometimes just by believing, even if I kept quiet, people who saw me in 99 when I was very sick, if they see me now, they will certainly ask, if they fear to ask me, they'll ask Asia, but what happened? Then she would tell them, you don't know his own ARVs. And they would go, because they saw it dying in 1999.
Mm.
And I'm telling people that you don't have to go out there, go in on the radio and telling people, just follow your medicine well and look well. In the community, you will notice you have changed.
Mm.
And this will create demand. These 1.2 million people who are fearing will come out. Who, they will come out. You see, if I went for politics and I won, people will say, hey, but this is the same guy who did what? Was dying. So they will come out. So this is what we are pushing for. We are pushing for improvement in all areas, not just say that we have improved, yes, therefore you clap, the others you leave. We have said the same, for example, with education, that we are very happy that most Ugandan children are going to school. But we have asked, is the quality the same? Is the child going to my primary school, primary school where I went, getting the same education as the one who's going to Kampala parents? We agree, all of you agree, of course, no.
Mm-hmm.
So these are some of the panel questions I'm asking. For even this universal coverage, is it good for all of us? Would Honorable Minister be able to happy to go to a health center in his village to get treatment from there? That's what we're asking.
Mm-hmm.
And someone said on message that could it be that government is thinking that HIV is no longer a big issue and now taking resources elsewhere where we have bigger issues like non-communicable diseases? That as a parent, you could do that. If you think you have solved one problem, you go elsewhere.
You go somewhere else.
That, do you think government feels that way? That HIV is no longer a big problem? Or maybe donors, do you think they think that way?
Well, I hope they don't, because we have shown by statistics that we are not out of the bush yet.
Mm.
The figures say that. We are very grateful, let's face it.
Mm-hmm.
There was a time when we were losing 100,000 people, even 200,000 people annually. We have come to 10 to 20%. You can say we have reduced by 90%. That's true. But this 21, one of them could be your sister or could be your friend. could be one of my friends. I don't want to hear Asia is one of them. I don't want to hear Hillary, oh, his sister is one of them. So when you personalize it, then you realize that this is not good. You see, they can say something controls 99%, but if you are among the 1%, you don't want to be among that. That's why we are pushing for improvement, continuous improvement. But as it were, that we have done well, but we can do better. We need to improve. And we are saying that if we are to reach 2020 the way we are doing now, it's like we must fast track. And I like the issue of fast tracking. Yeah. I pay my money from Kireka, where I live, going to Kampala, but I reach somewhere, there is a traffic jam. The meeting is, so I get off the taxi, although I've paid the money, I jump on a border.
And you pay
my and pour my money. But I reach the border, so can't, so I leave the border and run to make sure that I reach the station at the right time. That's exactly what we are saying. They have done well. We invested in the transport, in a taxi. We are now getting on a taxi, but we must get there in time. Therefore, we must use more resources.
And I think it's once the science is understood, it's also clear that just because the way to go is shorter or closer doesn't mean it's easier or cheaper, and also doesn't mean you can avoid it or you can say,
oh, you can stop because you have not reached.
we'll go work on this other thing. No, because that's part of why there's stubbornly high incidence of new infection is because of that unsuppressed viral load in communities. They're related. So HIV can also resurge. You can chronically neglect or misinvest and then see incidents creep up beyond what we're talking about now, beyond these 1,000 infections per week, to higher and higher, and then it becomes more of a problem. And that what seemed like, oh, the light was at the end of the tunnel, no, suddenly we're back 10 years. So that's exactly why this surge in investment, this course correction around laws, policies, service delivery models, engagement of people with HIV themselves, that's why these must come front and center in order to truly achieve the defeat by 2030 that we know is possible, but won't happen unless these things are taken on.
You have something to say?
I think in addition to what my colleagues have said, there's need to increase investment, domestic investment in our health system, but also enhance integration, because the resources are limited, but we need to use them efficiently to ensure that we get to the people that need them, but also we provide quality services. And then we need to invest in community interventions. Community interventions are critical. I know the health system is key at the moment, but you find that it can't work alone. Without community systems enhanced investment in that, you find that probably we'll be running, but at the same time running backwards, because we'll be leaving some people behind, but also we'll not get to where we want to go if we don't invest in community systems. And in addition, in monitoring and ensuring accountability. Because however much we put in this money and we sit back, if the money is misappropriated, it's not efficiently used, you find that probably we are pouring water in a basket, that we might not attain what we want to attain at the end of the day. I think that's what I have to say.
Okay, we are going to break for a short break. Now, when we come back, we'll be doing closing remarks. But I would like us to think through and also now give individual responsibility. What do you want the listener to do in order to contribute to the end of AIDS by 2030? And then I want us to do something. I don't know whether it's ethical or not. I want us to give a vote out of 100%. Each one, I want you to vote for the country's effort up to yesterday. And also, I want us to vote, to give a vote on hope. How much hope do you have that by 2030, going by what we have, like assuming what you have said, Okay, I don't know. Assuming that the way we have been moving is the same, are we going, what hope do you have that we shall achieve our target by 2030? So we shall give two votes. Do you vote for how we have performed, and a vote of hope, how much hope do you have? And that will sound, because it will also be like a kind of evaluation of our effort. So viewers, we have seen that our problems can be solved. Uganda has that capacity to end AIDS by 2030, but we need more investment. We need to bring people who are harder to bring into treatment. We need to bring to change laws. We need to decriminalize things like sex work, drug use. I don't know. They have implications, but this is done for the sake of saving all lives, not the lives of sex workers or men who have sex with men. We need to find a way to link more people to ART. And Asia has said, yes, we can clap at coverage, but what quality? We need to think of quality of services. We need to work on healthcare, especially the workforce. We need to motivate them more. We need to work on corruption, of course. Adherence, we need to follow up the science that has come in. We need more innovations. Dr. Watiti talked of retention care, retention effort, that people who are on ARVs stay, and all that. So we break now, and when we come, we shall be concluding. This is our final segment. Welcome back from that break. So our final segment, we've been discussing our hope to end AIDS by 2030. That's the government target, and also promise. Yesterday we were thumping our chests saying we are getting there. And so a team of experts here have been analyzing what we need to achieve an end of AIDS, which is described as a situation where HIV no longer causes death. You may get it, but first of all, there are more preventive tools to stop you from getting it. But if you get it, it doesn't kill you. You live with it to your normal lifespan. I want to give all of you a chance to sum up our discussions. But I want us to add in now an element, because we can't say government should do this, NGOs should do this, donors should do this, God should do this. But the only thing we can control is us. Mm. So what can I do? What stones should I throw in the fight? What, in order to help achieve the end of AIDS by 2030? So I'll start with you, Asia. Just because we are close to me.
One thing everyone can do is join civil society efforts to increase accountability. So there is the personal actions, of course, knowing your status if you don't know your status already, having safer sex if you don't do that already, helping people take their medicine, taking your medicine regularly. Of course, those things are all expectations that will go a long way toward a path of success. But I'd like to talk about something else that people can do, which is to get involved as leaders in civic space. When government hears, whether it's a member of parliament or a district health official, that the quality of service is poor, that helps. That's not finding fault. That's people using their voice using the evidence that they have as a consumer of health services to bring about change. And I think that's the power that we have, whether it's in Uganda or around the world, as concerned people who are concerned about the welfare of those who need HIV prevention and treatment, is that we can all actually stand up and demand improved services. We can join civil society efforts that are taking place to increase the budget increment for health, to increase accountability, to call out poor service delivery when they see it, and to really push even further.
It's the how that I don't understand. Should we demonstrate on the street? What should we do?
It depends on what it is that we're working on. And I would say, look into the organizations of the panelists here today, whether it's UNASO or NAFOPANU, Health Gap. And there are many ways that people can reach out and get involved in small ways, in big ways. But it starts with getting informed about what the quality of services are and what is needed. And then engaging, whether it's in a very small way or in a more substantial way. And we find advocacy helps people live longer lives. When people feel empowered and invested in their own health and the health of their communities, whether it's HIV, diabetes, other causes of preventable illness, when people feel like they have agency and power, it helps lead to a better success, better outcomes, and overall a more accountable government structures for delivering health services, and a more healthy society.
I think you're right, because as members of this government, of this Uganda family, we have our expectations, but we also use it as a feedback on whether our expectations are being covered. And before we go to Dr. Stephen Watiti, I'd like to apologize to our viewers that the three members who are supposed to join us, we failed to get through them. They were ready, but our technology got some issues. And we apologize to them too, sorry members, but we thank you for being part of the process, and we shall reach out to you to get your views so that we deliver them to the public at the right time. So, Dr. Stephen, what do you think you can sum up together with individual responsibility?
Well, I want to start off with I'm a student of Luganda, and in Baganda have a saying which says that Nyamantono wakane elimu nkwawa.
I thought it was Okayana.
Okay, Okayana. Okayana, whatever.
What is stronger?
Okayana. I'm asking for more, but you don't throw away what you have. So I'm appealing to my fellow people living with HIV, the close to 1.5 million Ugandans that go and test, those who have not yet tested. But those who have tested, don't criticize the services so much that you don't use them. Go and use them. But as we use them, we will keep improving. Certainly we have seen there are gaps. But we see with quality, they say quality is a moving target. You cannot say I've hit it. You have to keep improving until you die. We need to keep improving. So what I'm requesting is that go and register massively for ART. Register at any center. We have over 1,840 ART centers in the whole country. Go to the one nearest you, the one more convenient for you. Register. You will see some problems there, but don't rubbish everything. Let's keep improving. We can work together. We shall work together, as it was said. The other thing I want to say is the importance of learning some facts about this disease. We should know what causes it. We know how the disease affects the body. And I already mentioned the importance of you when you have tested to demand that you have your CD4 count checked. And when it is checked, if it is less than 200, it means you are in danger. You need to make more noise. Call us. Let's join you, and we see that you are helped. If we do this, then one, we shall stop the new infection, because all the people who have the disease, like me, our viral load will be suppressed, and we know that a suppressed viral load is not transmittable. Therefore, we shall not infect our loved ones, be they babies or sexual partners with the disease. Then the second thing is that we shall not die of AIDS. We have seen the statistics are not yet very good. We want zero. Mm. We don't want any person to die of this disease. So with those, I want to say thank you. I would say we have scored highly. We have passed, but we have not got 100% because there are many people. Mm. Our idea is to make sure that every person is helped. We thank you.
Thank you, Doctor. And I like the way you use analogies. I think you had an experience in public mobilization, the bus, the border, the running. Sylvia.
Thank you. I think what I would call upon our colleagues out there is, for those who don't know their status, please go out and get to know your status. But this is not a one-off, because there's a tendency that I tested in 2012, so this should be routine, especially if you're sexually active. But also for those who are on treatment, please ensure that you adhere to your treatment. There's support out there in our communities, at our health facilities, but also some NGOs, there are many out there, please reach out. The support is within our communities, but at times if you don't endeavor to go out, you find you die with your self-stigma at times. But also for our communities out there, I think we need to enhance our knowledge about HIV and AIDS. Let's know how it's transmitted. Let's know what happens if you have it. But also this can help us to reduce the stigma and discrimination. If someone told you I have HIV and AIDS, it's not that when you come closer to them, they will infect you. So we need to enhance our knowledge so that we support our colleagues, we support our friends, we support our families to adhere to treatment. Because if someone adheres to treatment, we know very well that they can't transmit the disease. But then also to enhance our efficiency, the way we are using our resources. I think as NGOs, our colleagues, government out there, we need to efficiently use the resources that we have. Because without that, we find that however much we invest in money, that money will not realize what we want, but also enhance domestic finances.
Okay, thank you, Sylvia. Still, now I'd like you to give me my vote as we close. Mm. How much do you vote for government so far out of 100?
As of
yesterday. So far, performance. Up to yesterday.
I think as of yesterday, I would give them 70%.
70%.
Yes.
And in hope of ending
HIV? In hope
of
getting there, if we mean if we change our business.
No, just hope right now.
Yeah. Right now.
The way you think.
The way things are, business as usual, I think we are still at 70%. Because without changing our business, we may not get there.
Thank you so much, Sylvia. Dr. Watiti?
Well, I would give 75%. I'll give 75%.
Of achievement?
Yeah, and with hope. I think if we follow this, it could be at 85.
Thank you. Asia?
So I'm an activist, and we have to be hopeful. We have no choice. So I think on hope, I mean, it is our hope that all parties can see the value of these course corrections that we've been able to describe today. So I maintain that hope. I think right now I'm a little more pessimistic because I know the things that are holding back that glass, the remaining part of the glass, are not easy things. They're about political will, they're about laws and policies, they're about how government prioritizes the most oppressed and the most vulnerable. They're about things like gender-based violence, about stigma and discrimination, these chronic, stubborn issues. And then they're about investing in people with HIV.
What percentage?
So I have to put it more at 55, 60, 55. But that hope is strong because this is the evidence. These aren't just...
And government performance?
Fine. How about the performance so far?
And that's what I'm saying. Is under three quarters full. So I would, let's say 65.
65.
65, right?
So the hope is 55?
The hope is stronger. I'd say hope, we have to keep hoping.
Yes.
Because doing the same thing and expecting different results, I mean, that's insanity, right?
Percentage. Hope is.
Oh, let's say 100%. That's my hope. That's my hope. But it's with making sure.
That is very optimistic.
Well, but you see, my first figure, it was lower. Mm. And that's because we are all very, very concerned that government will say, oh, because it looks like we're close to a 90, we can sit back and move on to these other
priorities. I think I have more hope in the community.
All right, members, we have run out of time. Thank you, viewers, for having been with us for the last 2 hours. We really hope you got a lot from this. And we really hope you got, especially your individual responsibility. Mm. I want to thank on behalf of the New Vision, Asia Russell for coming, Dr. Stephen Watiti for coming, and Sylvia Nakasi. Please, when we call you back, we hope we count on you, because this is a fight that we must see to the end.
Mm-hmm.
And I wish all of you a better hope, the hope that Asia has of 100. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hilary.
I have been Hilary Bainemijisha. I am an editor here at the New Vision, and I'm a media activist on HIV and also handle issues of health.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Wow. Okay.